I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences. Welcome to Causes. As a public land grant university, the University of the District of Columbia conducts research and provides community outreach programs to expand knowledge about urban agriculture and urban sustainability here in the District of Columbia and at our research farm in Beltsville, Maryland. One of our neighbors at the farm is the Beltsville Agricultural Research Center, BARC for short. Over these past several months, we have been working with researchers from BARC on various projects to build knowledge and information to benefit residents of the District of Columbia. BARC sponsored a conference on urban agriculture that we held a few weeks ago here at the university's Van Ness campus. And recently, BARC donated 22 tons of compost for the urban farm we are building with a coalition of partners at East Capitol Street. Joining me on this program is the director of the Beltsville Agricultural Research Center, Dr. Ellen Harris. Dr. Harris's own research is in the field of nutrition and nutritional health. Dr. Harris, welcome to Causes.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here.
Thank you. So tell us about BARC. What is it that you do up in Beltsville at the Research Center?
Okay. Well, first I have to give you a little spiel on where we are within the government.
Yes.
We are part of the Agricultural Research Service, ARS for short, which is one agency within the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Our agency is divided up by areas, and we are located within the northeast area. And in Beltsville, BARC is one of three centers. The Beltsville Human Nutrition Research Center is another, and then the U.S. National Arboretum, which is actually located in D.C., is the third center. Within BARC, we are about 600 plus people, and that consists of scientists and lots of support people, research support people such as technicians, what we call support scientists. We have postdoctoral fellows that come. We also have students, be they in graduate school, undergraduate school, or high school even, that come and work within our center, in the lab and other parts of the center. We have other support staff, such as people who do the administrative work. We have, because we are a working research farm and we are a self-containing facility, we're over 6,500 acres.
Wow, that's big.
Yes, we have people who maintain the facility in terms of the buildings. We have water waste treatment plants. We have our own electrical grid. We have people who maintain the physical plant for the center. And then we have what we call research support services people. Again, because it's a working farm, we have production fields. So we have people who work out in the fields. We have people who work with the animals because we do animal research as well. So we run the gamut of, it's sort of like a little mini city or community. And on the research side, we have 18 laboratories, and the Agricultural Research Service is divided up by programs. So we have what we call animal production and protection programs. We have crop production and protection programs. We have natural resources programs, and then we have nutrition, food safety, and quality programs. So within BARC, we just about have everything except nutrition and aquaculture, something that we don't do. and maybe one or two other things. Mm-hmm. But because of our size, we fall under the majority of those mm-hmm. programs.
Well, you're a lot bigger operation than we are here in our college.
Yes.
So animal research, of course, you know, we don't do much of that mm-hmm. Because of our urban focus, but mm-hmm. we do have one common animal that we both have. We have beehives mm-hmm. at our farm, and mm-hmm. I know you have done a good right. bit of research on bees, which is, of course, very important for right. crop production.
Well, on the animal side, we have insects, of course, are fall under the animal side. Mm-hmm. We have the bee research lab. Mm-hmm. We have the animal biosciences and biotechnology lab. They predominantly do research on poultry and swine. Mm-hmm. Then we have the animal parasitic diseases mm-hmm. laboratory, and they work across the animal species with poultry and, mm-hmm. and swine and cattle, because they're interested, their work is in dealing with parasitic diseases. Mm-hmm. And then we have the Animal Genomics and Improvement Laboratory, and they primarily work with beef and, you know, and dairy cattle. Mm-hmm. And we do have a dairy on site, wow. and so that is a facility that we're very proud of. It's challenging because Maryland isn't considered really a dairy state,
yes.
but our herd, which consists of about 120 mm-hmm. cows and then 130 or so replacement heifers, we run that 24/7. Mm-hmm. 7 days a week.
Yeah.
We milk the cows twice a day, and our herd manager is very proud that we, in terms of production and efficiency, we're at the top.
So tell us a little bit more about sustainable agriculture, because of course that's mm-hmm. very close to mm-hmm. our hearts here mm-hmm. and very much at the center of our work.
Okay.
So that's a big topic.
Yes.
What all does it encompass?
Right. Well, we have one group that's called the Sustainable Agricultural mm-hmm. Systems Lab, but sustainable agriculture also runs the gamut.
Mm-hmm.
It's finding environmental friendly ways to grow food, raise animals within the constraints that we are faced with now in terms of climate change,
yeah.
Issues with water.
Yeah.
So the Sustainable Agricultural Systems Lab, or SASL as we call mm-hmm. them, they look at various farming systems, mm-hmm. till and no tillage mm-hmm. methods to work on that side in terms of growing foods, but they also look at things like cover crops
mm-hmm.
and weeds that might be good for the quality, improving the quality of the soil,
mm-hmm.
Containing carbon,
mm-hmm.
And just helping to grow food in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
But there's interactions with other labs, such as the hydrology and remote mm. sensing laboratory mm-hmm. that we have. This group works very much with NASA
uh-huh.
and looking at satellite data so that you get a broad sweep of what a landscape might look like, where water is and where water isn't. We have a group that's focused on climate change, but they do it in terms of looking at how you might grow things in chambers. So they have outside chambers and they have inside chambers where you can control the moisture, you can control the soil content and introduce various factors that might influence the growth of a crop.
So this is really interesting. You're linking with computer science a lot, right?
Yes.
With big data,
mm-hmm.
and analyzing
mm-hmm.
a lot of
yeah.
data.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, and that's one of the very interesting things about agricultural research,
mm-hmm.
Where it is agriculture, but when you talk about research, it involves all the sciences.
Mm-hmm.
So we have engineers, we have molecular biologists, we have chemists, we have entomologists. I mean, it just runs the gamut
mm-hmm.
of, and that's what we like to tell young people,
yes.
is, and especially young people of color, because
yeah.
of historical issues related to slavery and farm workers, that it's an area to go into, not to shy away from, because you can do so many things with sciences, with technology. It's a whole suite
yeah.
of things that you could develop a career around.
Yeah. And it doesn't start with the food production either, right? That's, I mean, it just starts there. It doesn't end with the food production. There's a lot of processing and knowledge
well,
in that.
Well, it's a system.
Yeah.
And I'm a nutritionist by training.
Yeah.
And coming into agricultural research, you know, sometimes from a pure agriculture side, you'll have people just, you know, talking about the plants, talking about the animals, talking about natural resources. But I like to say the plants don't eat themselves. there's a huge human factor here.
Yeah.
And in terms of practices towards production, but also the end result for consumption.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to include the human factor.
Absolutely.
So it's very much interconnected.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where nutrition and agriculture are
mm-hmm.
very much interconnected.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned your international work. I'm sure that was a big factor in your international work, that's in the connection between agriculture and human health.
Well, it's more so on that side than
mm-hmm.
it here domestically, and I think that's because we've had the advantage of abundance.
Yeah.
But on the international side, especially when you're going to developing countries where, you know, there have been ag projects and then nutrition projects
mm-hmm.
here, and nutrition is always on the health side. And these two groups could be sometimes in the same area or very neighboring areas, but they never crossed.
Mm-hmm.
And the donor organizations and our government as well is learning that you have to interconnect. You know, so if you're developing a biofortified sweet potato or yam
mm-hmm.
and adding vitamin A,
mm-hmm.
but you create it and it's working perfectly, but then the people don't accept it because
yeah.
they're used to eating white yam.
Mm-hmm.
But the agricultural people might not have thought years back to look at food preferences and
mm-hmm.
see what people would eat and would not eat
mm-hmm.
or what would need to be done to prepare them
mm-hmm.
for an introduction of a new food.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
that's where there's a lot of work going on towards linking nutrition
mm-hmm.
and agriculture.
Mm-hmm. Very, very important
mm-hmm.
work. And
mm-hmm.
you know, we look at that, of course, also in our own research, both
mm-hmm.
in terms of what is the nutrient density in the food,
right.
But also what is the acceptance.
Mm-hmm.
Because right here in the district, we have neighborhoods that are food deserts,
right.
where we really have to encourage getting fresh food to people and
mm-hmm.
and helping them learn how to
mm-hmm.
use it. So
mm-hmm.
terrifically important research.
Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned young people, and I have to confess, when I studied, I'm an ag economist, right? So when I started out, I ended up in agriculture because I couldn't decide between biology and chemistry, and you know, I had all these different interests, and so ended up in agriculture because I could do everything, which was great.
Right.
So what is your advice to young people? Where's the field going? And you know, how can we get them sort of interested and intrigued with the kind of research opportunities that there are?
I think you have to, you know, you have to start young. And at our center, for example, we have what we call a discovery garden. And it's taken care of by volunteer staff, because it takes a lot of work. And they have areas within the garden that are related to different species of plants, vegetables, pollinators, etc. And there are partnerships with schools where the children can come and volunteer to help clean out the garden, prepare it for the next growing season, and then come spring through fall, early fall, we have students that visit, and from itty bitty nursery school kids who probably don't know a thing about it, but they love seeing, you know, the big sunflowers and seeing, you know, tomatoes growing, you know, because there's education in all of that, you know. And but then we have elementary school kids and middle school kids come, and they can spend however long they want, you know, and then we have like a picnic area where nearby where they can have lunch or what have you. Then we have programs with local high schools where a lot of the, in Maryland, for example, they have a senior project requirement. So we have students that come and they are matched with scientists and they work on projects in the lab and you know, design the experiment, write it up, do it, create a poster, because we have an annual poster day that our scientists and postdocs and the students can participate in. And it's also a competition because we have judges, and so you know, they select the best, and you know, first, second, third prize type thing. And a lot of those students that do the during the year projects can also do internships during the summer. And depending on our availability of funds, we have a very significant summer internship program, and where students can come and work through the summer. And we have had experiences where if the student is really interested or just gets that spark from the experience, they have been associated with a particular lab from high school all the way to receiving a doctorate. We have examples of that. So that's, you know, a lot of it is exposure. And especially, again, I go back to communities of color. If you don't have role models, experiences are the avenue for that. So we really pride ourselves in the fact that we do offer those opportunities. And you get them from elementary all the way up. And when people are, you know, when they're, when students have reached a certain age and they can really work in the lab and see the potential of opportunities, then that, I think that's the spark that you, you provide for.
And we call that experiential learning.
Right? Exactly, exactly.
And we share that passion, not just for the research, but for really training the next generation of researchers.
And that everybody isn't, but everybody isn't in science, or may not have an interest in science. And that's another beauty of BARC being so comprehensive, because the science does not get done just by the scientists.
Yeah.
It's a whole community that makes it possible.
Yeah.
So, you know, we have people on the research support services side who are driving combines. And that combine might be special equipment mm-hmm. that the scientist has programmed to measure certain elements like the soil or moisture the quality of the crop that's being harvested.
Mm-hmm.
And that combine driver is the one who's working that equipment.
Yeah.
So that's a skill,
yeah.
you know, that you just don't get walking on the,
yeah.
off the street. So a young person who might not be interested in science, but is interested in the outdoors, is interested in nature, is interested in equipment,
mm-hmm.
could still find a path
mm-hmm.
with us.
Within agriculture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for this inspiring conversation.
Okay.
My guest has been Dr. Ellen Harris, Director of the Beltsville Agricultural Research Center of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. As your public land-grant university, we are always eager to share what we learn from our colleagues like the Beltsville Agricultural Research Center and to pass it on to district residents and organizations. We are committed to conducting research and offering education programs that improve your quality of life and economic opportunity. And we share our knowledge about urban agriculture, urban sustainability, and nutritional health, not only in our classrooms and laboratories where we teach our academic programs, but you will find us in churches, synagogues, community centers, and at farmers markets, offering workforce development programs, certificates, and workshops for people of all ages and of all walks of life. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.